How about this little fact? Montel is best known as the host of the long-running daytime talk show, The Montel Williams Show, 1991-2008. That deserves a round of applause. Great work for many years. He's active in the not-for-profit MS Foundation, which he founded after being diagnosed with multiple sclerosis in 1999, just last year. Montel suffered a stroke and has recently been speaking out about ensuring that everyone knows the signs and symptoms of stroke. And he's no stranger to the city of Baltimore. Not at all. Born here, attended school here, and get this, his father was Baltimore's first African-American fire chief, and so many more things about him. He's not just a great broadcaster, media icon. He is a leader in our nation and someone who has a powerful message. Put your hands together for Montel Williams.
Thank you, Steve. Mountain, get out of my way. I'll say it again. Mountain, get out of my way. That's a mantra I've lived by my entire life. I'm happy to be here today because I'm back home. I was born less than a mile by the crow fly from here in a little area of Baltimore called Cherry Hill, which used to be Baltimore's biggest ghetto. As a matter of fact, the location of the first Superfund cleanup site in the United States of America, because Bethlehem Steel had so contaminated this city. I was born and raised one block from that dump. And I remember as a child running around through the trash at that dump, chasing rats out of the trash so the older kids could shoot them with BB guns. And I wonder why now at this age, I suffer from so many neurological disorders. But it's okay, because like I said, mountain, get out of my way. I don't care what the obstacle is. It could be as big as the biggest mountaintop. If you have knowledge, you have faith, and you have the ability to literally work with that knowledge and faith, you can overcome any obstacle. I know I have. Being a child born in the ghetto, I was never supposed to be a person who graduated from the United States Naval Academy. Absolutely not. 90% of the kids who were born in the neighborhood I was born in wound up either dead or in jail. The statistics that you hear about. I'm here. Why? Because I obtained the knowledge that I needed to make sure I could apply it in a way that could help me overcome those obstacles. But I'm so happy to be here talking to an organization like yours, Hackensack Meridian. I just came back about 6 days ago as part of a delegation with your governor to India on a business junket to promote business in India of New Jersey. And I know that they were extremely excited to hear him and extremely excited about the potential possibilities of partnering up with organizations out of New Jersey to make sure they move initiatives like medical initiatives forward. I have been a part of the medical community since I was about 3 years old, or less, really. One of my earliest memories in life, and it's really kind of crazy, but one of my earliest memories of life was about 18, 19 months old. Literally, I pulled a boiling pot of hot water off of the stove while my mother was cooking and covered 60% of my body. Almost boiled 60% of the skin off of my body. I spent 3 months in hyperbaric chamber here in Baltimore City with salves all over my body, keeping my skin on. And whether people say, oh, you can't remember that, I remember it distinctly. I remember the nurses coming in to help my hand. I remember the doctors at a time when, let's get back to the 1950s, where this country was more or at least as segregated and as racist and as attitudinal as it is today. And don't think it's not. And I remember it didn't matter what the color that doctor was, that nurse was, that came in that took care of me. They came in and left an impression on me that even runs till today. And that was an impression that they cared. And they worked really hard to make sure that I maintained the skin on my body. And from that moment on, as soon as I was able to get out of that hyperbaric chamber, I was my mother's worst nightmare. I was probably in Baltimore Mass General Hospital, I'm telling you, no less than 15 times. I was running in the house with a stick in my mouth, almost pushing through the back of my brain. 2 weeks in the hospital for that. I used to run around without shoes on, playing, and got phlebitis so bad in my groin that I spent a month in a hospital then, by age 6. I don't remember literally growing up in Cherry Hill without being in the hospital. And every time I was there, I remember some of the nurses, some of the doctors, who literally came into me and really acted like they cared. Spent my formative years in Anne Arundel County, Glen Burnie. And then when I, as a product of busing, you know, I was bused from the all-black neighborhood called Morris Hill over to the all-white neighborhoods to integrate school. And I remember very distinctly the people protesting outside of the school, calling me by name, calling me every name in the book, and why they didn't want me to be in that school. But still, being able to participate in everything I wanted to participate in Andover High School, ascending to the point that I was my junior year, the president of my class, senior year, the president of my class, junior year, I was the Chesapeake Regional Association of Student Councils parliamentarian my senior year, their adjutant. I was elected to the Board of Education in Anne Arundel County, the first student ever done so in the country, elected to a Board of Education here in the state. Went on to graduate from high school and enlisted in the Marine Corps. Spent my time at Parris Island. Got out of Parris Island, was meritoriously promoted to the rank of PFC. And then, quickly, within 3 months, meritoriously promoted two more times to the rank of corporal. But while stationed at 29 Palms, California, I had one of my first nightmares with the medical industry. I had a young Marine Corps doctor who thought he was going to get the Nobel Prize, who misdiagnosed me with male breast cancer and performed a radical mastectomy on my chest when, even before he got a biopsy back, when all that was wrong with me was a case of gynecomastia. This man raped my chest. It made me literally spend the next 20 years of my life lifting weights and doing anything I could to reshape the figures of my muscles in my chest to give the impression that nothing was wrong with me. So I have that as the nightmare. And while that happened, I literally got selected to go to the Naval Academy. It almost stopped me from going to the academy because I had to almost went through chemotherapy. And it would have been unnecessary because all I had was gynecomastia. Get to the Naval Academy. While at the Naval Academy, when I'm a graduate of the class of 1980, I'm the first and only person to ever walk across a stage at the Naval Academy, receive their diploma, get to throw their hat in the air, and not be commissioned on the same day. And why? Because 6 weeks before I graduated, we were the last class at the Naval Academy that the U.S. military used the automatic gun with when giving out immunizations. And I happened to be one of the first 100 people through the line. The first 60 of us that went through the line got a 6 times higher dosage of diphtheria and typhoid than anybody else. Sent me right into the hospital. I went blind in my left eye. And though the overdose did not cause my MS, because it was probably something that I had as a genetic trait, because my mother is half Scottish and half African American, so she has probably carried the gene that gave me the gene, but it was that abuse of my immune system that triggered what would have been my first episode or bout. And at the Naval Academy, because at that time, I was running around, honestly, it's really pretty cool. I'm the exact same size I was when I graduated from the Naval Academy. 6 foot tall, 180 pounds, 32 inch waist. And no one at that time, let's go back, 1980, Remember all the literature. Not one bit of literature in this country ever said that MS was a disease that could be found in African Americans, and especially in men. Back then, they were still calling this a disease of women and saying that most of them, it was just something that was in wrong in their head. So I ended up going 20 years misdiagnosed. And they look at me, put me on a medical hold from May when I graduated until December, where then I used then Congresswoman Mikulski, the Senator Salabays, and I almost sued the U.S. military and said, hold on a second. I did my 4 years at the academy. I did everything I was supposed to do to be commissioned, and you will commission me, period. And I won. So I ended up getting my commission right before I graduated, in December. And because, this is really kind of crazy, because I had entered the Naval Academy as a Marine, I couldn't go back into the Marine Corps because the Marine Corps had a requirement that you had to have correctable vision to 20/20. And my vision was uncorrectable. I had a large scotoma in my left eye, large blind spot. And so they ended up commissioning me as a special duty intelligence officer in the Navy. And the reason why I got that was because I had studied Chinese at the academy, so therefore they could give me something that was a job either special duty intelligence or supply corps. I said, I'm not gonna be a supply corps officer, so boom, special duty intelligence. I ended up spending more time, and that's supposed to be NPQ, not physically qualified position. I ended up spending more time at sea and deployed and in conflict zones than any of my contemporaries or peers. I have well over 390 days on the water and well over 360 days under the water on multiple missions that were our highest priority missions that the U.S. military had at the time. I held for a 16-year retirement. I was doing a credit, Steve, but my service spanned over 22 years. So back when I was a special duty intelligence officer, I held the highest clearances that this country has to offer. Not just top secret, but top secret SI. And I served out my time. But every 3 months, 4 months, something would go weird. Just my body would feel weird. I was running around. I used to think that you know, the more space you take up as a man, the more man you were. So I was one of these power lifters that, you know, period of time, I blew myself up to almost 225 pounds, trying to hide the damage from my chest. But I blew myself up that big. Lifting weights, I used to be able to squat over 700 pounds. I used to be able to deadlift well over 600 pounds. Thinking that, again, the more and more of that I did, the more of a man I would be. But the truth of the matter is that we know that all I did was do damage to my back and damage to my joints from throwing that much weight around. When I got out of the service, I got out of service because I had started a program speaking to America's youth on my leave time. When I was going around the country, speaking in high schools and colleges across this country, talking to kids about staying in school, staying away from drugs, and staying away from negative youth trends, from dropping out and drugging out. And that helped me then form a company that was called a nonprofit called Reach the American Dream, that I ended up giving out about $1 million worth of scholarships and stipends to students across this country. I spoke to over 1,500 high schools across the country, about 1.5 million people in a 3-year period of time. And everybody wondered, why was my show so successful when it started? It was because I was out everywhere I went around the country. It was a media event. So I would speak here in Baltimore, I spoke in Denver, I spoke all over the country. And every time I spoke in a school, the local 5, the local 2, the local 3, the local 7, 13, every channel would show up in the school. How could this guy speak in a high school auditorium with high school kids, put all the teachers out of the room, and maintain control? And it was because I spoke to them, I think, in a language that they understood. And when I went on the air, and I had sold my talk show without agent or manager, I received all the agent and manager fees for my show when I actually launched it. When I put that show on the air, everybody wondered why the show was so successful. It was because there was 1.5 million kids across the country who had saw me in their high school. And they went, that's a guy that came to my school. And my show's ratings went up very, very quickly. But all along the way, every 3 or 4 months, some glitch would happen. Meaning I lose more vision in my left eye, I got a little weak on my left arm, so I lift more weights, got a little weak in my back, lift more weights, thinking that I could counterbalance what was going on. And it wasn't until I had a really crazy incident that took place in New York. It was really kind of insane, but this is what happened. Give me my cue. For about 2 months in a row, I started bleeding out of my nose every morning at 2 o'clock in the morning. And then one day, that bleeding just continued to the point that I remember laying at the hospital at Beth Israel North in New York and watched that happen. I was laying in the hospital because I had been bleeding the night before so profusely. They took me in, and it was an interventionist radiology hospital that was going to go up and perform a surgery inside of my nose to stop the bleeding. And instead, the night before the surgery, I started bleeding across the bed, flatlined. And I remember distinctly watching that happen. And the next morning, after they got me back together again, I literally went through a 17-hour surgery. They went up through all through my brain, tamponaded it out, one of the blood vessels in here, blocked it off. I sprouted new collaterals that seemed to ease the pressure, and then it stopped. That was almost 20 years ago. 20 years ago in about a month. And I had such an epiphany about my life. I thought, I literally, the closest to death that I had ever come. And I literally changed the way I acted about everything in my life. I recognized that, yes, these doctors did save my life, but it was incumbent upon me to make sure that I maintained the precious gift that they gave me. And I devoted myself to changing every aspect of everything I did. From the way I eat, the way I exercise, the way I sleep, the way I interact with people, I changed everything. Knowing that this could have an impact on my health. And it was 3 months later that I went through the most horrific bout that I had had with MS. I'll tell you a very funny story. How many of you remember the television show Touched by an Angel? Remember that? Della Reese and the little angel thing, right? Well, I did a guest starring appearance on that show. I'm the only person on that show that, remember at the end of the show, no matter how bad you were, they look over at the angel and she would go and save their life and they go straight to heaven, right? They looked over at me, she looked over at me and went, sent me straight to hell. I played a character who was a cult leader that was about to burn up a church and all these people. And so at the end of the episode, instead of them saving me, I literally went to purgatory. But the crazy thing about that episode was that, this really great director, and the director was wanted me to cry, multiple times. I spoke on the phone about a week before the episode was supposed to be shot, and he said, you ought to go see an acting coach and see if we can get you to rub gas. We got some things that we can do. I can put some ammonia on your eyes and things like that that'll help you cry. But there's a couple of times that you have to cry on cue. Well, I woke up the Friday morning, getting ready to fly out to, and they shot the show at the time in Utah. So I was flying from New York out to Utah to do the show. And I remember I got on an airplane, and the second I sat down, my feet went on fire. Literally seemed to be burning at a point that I couldn't even, it was so bad, I almost screamed on this aircraft flying across the country. And what that was, my first or second real episode or bout with MS. I didn't know it at the time. Flew all the way out to Utah. Literally, I needed to have help to leave the plane, to get down to baggage claim to get my things. And I happened to just luckily be staying with a very close friend of mine who was a doctor. And that doctor, when I walked in the door, he said to my then ex-wife, "I know what's wrong with your husband." And the next morning he set me up with an appointment with a doctor who I went to see was a neurologist, who literally when I walked in the room, he did, you know, a little evaluation of me. And with the dumbest look on his face he could possibly have, he said, "You know what? You have MS. Don't worry about it, my friend. You know what? You'll get through it. But, you know, I want you to know that African Americans do the worst with this disease, just so you know." And left me. And I wanted to punch him in his face so badly, you don't know. When he came back in the room, and he came back in the room and he said to me again, he goes, "Look, you know, I'm really sorry here. I got a brochure. I got a this. I got a that." Hands me a couple pieces of paper. And a piece of paper that he had was something that he had just printed out. And, you know, this is beginning of the internet. He had just printed out this piece of paper that had this information on it talking about there were some studies that were done that showed that African-American males were the worst category with MS. Why would you give that to somebody when you just told them about you have a life-changing illness? And he did so. And I remember distinctly saying, "How dare you think you're going to be the crystal ball that knows everything? I mean, you may be a doctor, but you are not God. And if you were God, none of us would be sick." So I heard what he had to say, and it was that moment that I decided again, it's time to take charge of my life. I went up then on that fledgling internet and found everything I could possibly find. I could say that my degree is in engineering. I had a minor in international security affairs, and I approached this as if I was studying something for engineering. I needed to know everything, or as much as anybody talking to me knew about this disease, MS. And what I found out was that the literature had nothing in it whatsoever that really corresponded to thinking about how African American males do with the disease called MS. And I started working very, very hard at this. I was seen at Harvard, the Nobel Institute, Karolinska Institute, Stockholm, Sweden, Johns Hopkins, seen at UC San Francisco, the Mayo Clinic. Every place I went to, there was not an answer provided by any one of the doctors that I saw, really. Nothing greater than what I got out of the information in the literature. And over the last now 20 years since that diagnosis, I've literally been involved in multiple experimental programs that are things that really aren't in the mainstream. But part of the reason why I stand here today. 10 years ago, my diagnosis was increased from remitting relapsing to primary progressive. And I started on an investigatory device out of the University of Wisconsin that literally mitigated 90% of my symptoms. I'm still using that device today. But what I find out is so ignorant is that's why I'm using it. Not only am I using it, but I ended up capturing the IP of this device from the University of Wisconsin and taking this public. Getting this spending, I raised well over $100 million, helped to raise over $100 million in the last 10 years. And this device now deployed and actually got a CE mark in Canada, about to get a CE mark in Australia and the EU. We are treating patients to the tune of 150 patients right now outside of the United States. But because of the ignorance involved in some of our approvals here in this country, this is therapy that's not available to other Americans. I have cut the cost of my health care in the last 10 years by probably 90%. If you look and compare to the average person with primary progressive MS in America today, that bill is somewhere around $150,000 to $200,000 a year. I see my doctors once a year. And they're happy that I only have to see them once a year. But because we have so many hurdles that we are forced to, in some ways, just ridiculously have to jump over to get treatments and treatment available to people in this country, I find it almost criminal that I get to be able to walk around this way when I see MS patients all the time who are reaching out to me begging to be a part of this program. And I have to say, there's nothing I can do for you here in the United States. Fly to Canada. I'll guarantee you can get some help. I wish that's where my whole medical journey ended, but it's not. A year and a month ago, I had a major hemorrhagic stroke. And I say major, this is not me saying, these are the doctors at New York Presbyterian and several other hospitals that I've seen. I've never seen a person who has had the size stroke that I've had recover so quickly and bounce back to normal so fast. I said, doctors right now, I see my doctors now every 6 months for this, and they are baffled by how I'm able to do this. Part of it, I think, is the neuroprotection that's been provided by the experimental treatment that I've gone through for MS, but also I think it's because I took the time to figure out what I needed to do as best I could to help impact my medical footprint. Not only taking on this journey of my own medical issues to say to you that as you listen to all the stats and you get all the information about how to make yourselves much more productive and be able to make a lot more money and make sure you maintain your market share, I'm going to tell you that some of the information that maybe you're working on right now may not show the whole picture. You know, I've been walking back and forth up here and I'm thinking about, you know, a train track. And I've heard the last presentation, I haven't heard them all, and I don't know what else you're going to be talking about tomorrow. But we do know that in the next 5 to 10 years, if this was a train track, let's picture that track with a train over here. This train over here is called chronic illness. And we know right this second in the United States of America, depending on who you listen to, and depending on who you listen to, because the numbers are really close, anywhere from 45 to 60% of Americans in this country today have at least one chronic illness. And out of that 60%, we know that about 45% of them have at least two. And out of that, 20% of them have five or more. And as this population continues to age and that train's moving this way, coming from that direction, we got this train that's loaded up with nurses and doctors that are retiring. And again, depending on who you listen to, over the course of the next 5 to 10 years, we're going to be anywhere from 20,000 to 110,000 doctors short in this country. But let's make it even worse. Car number two, we're going to be close to 1 million nurses short in this country in less than 10 years. One train coming this way, one train going that way. When they collide together, you can talk about all the differences in, you know, copay, this pay, Medicare, I'm going to tell you that when a person finds out that they're going to have to be on a waiting list for a month before their child gets seen by a nurse? You think Americans, the people in the world have more guns than anyone else on the planet? There are more guns in this country than there are people? They're going to stand back and say, oh, it's okay. Take your time to treat me and my family? That's why I think one thing about speaking with you guys is just the joy. The program that you have right now, where you have some of your medical students assigned to families as part of their curriculum, helping them to build better relationships with those people that are out here right now that have to understand that it is our responsibility. So I'm going to tell you something. One of the things I think that the entire medical community in this country needs to do before we do anything else is impress upon politicians the fact that as we continue to destroy the next generation by not allowing them to exercise in schools, by taking away information about healthy eating and healthy lifestyle, you're setting up a generation that's going to be sicker than their parents, faster than their parents. You know, right now we have the largest obesity problem among people under 30 than we've ever had in the history of this country. And we know what goes along with obesity. Osteoarthritis, type 2, type 1 diabetes. All those things that absorb 90% of that $3.3 trillion spent on healthcare 2 years ago. 90% of it spent on people with chronic illness. Some of which is easily repairable if we just teach people how to take control of their individual healthcare footprint. You want to reduce costs? How about going back to the day when we had elementary school kids playing for an hour a day? How about we change the meals that we serve them from fast food to things that we know benefit their health? You hear a president of the United States talking about how we spent in the last 3 years trillions of dollars to improve our military hardware. But what they don't tell you is that 60% of the recruits that roll into boot camps can't pass the boot camp. We got to give them remedial boot camp to go to boot camp. Makes me wonder if we really are serious or we're just playing a game about making more money. If we're serious about outcomes with healthcare in this country, we really have to stop for a second and put some of these politicians in check and remind them that healthcare starts from within and provide the information to do so, which is something that you're doing. It's different than a lot of other healthcare systems in this country. And I applaud you for that. But also I want to tell you that I think what you got to do too is look around the room. And I'm not knocking anybody, but you know what? We're all in this room, like probably just a little bit older than 45 years old. I'm just saying. Okay? There's a few of them that aren't, you know, I got you. But even at our ages, you know, there's a guy by the name of Dr. Cooper out of Texas area who's been running a clinic in Texas and just completed a 20-year study of 20,000 people. Followed them over 20 years. His whole program is based on, he's the guy, I don't know if you know who Dr. Cooper is, but Dr. Cooper is the guy who actually coined the phrase aerobics. He invented it, the first person that actually used it in a medical peer-reviewed document. And part of his entire process with his patients is exercise, diet, mindfulness, and being aware of their own personal healthcare footprint. And his study just concluded that after 20 years, his 20,000 patients have a 40% lower cost of healthcare than their peers, and a 36% less chance of Alzheimer's, which, if you stop and think about for a minute, with our aging baby boomer population, that's going to be probably one of the biggest medical issues facing this country in its history, is the number of people who are going to have some sort of dementia or Alzheimer's. And the care that's going to have to go into taking care of them, the expense that's going to go into taking care of them, unless we figure out how to do something right now to impact it. I wish I had so much more time, because I think I have a few little ideas that might help move us in the right direction to see if we can get people to start thinking again about, just like we think about taxing corporations for their carbon footprint, we should be thinking about how we reinvigorate people to take responsibility for the health. Because right now, they just come to you and say, can I have a pill? Don't even think about whether or not there's something they can do to not have to take that pill. Can I have a pill? And yes, we have the pharmaceutical industry out there running like crazy to create the next new pill. for whatever it is that they can come up with to create another pill for. How about we stop the need for pills to begin with? And it's not going to happen for everybody. No, of course, cancer is there. Disease is here. We know that. But if we can get 40% of the people in this country to reduce their health care footprint and cost, think about the savings that we could have. Not the profits that we'll make, but the savings that we'll have and the ability we'll have to be able to treat people. Because the numbers speak for themselves. Whether we like it or not, in the next 10 years, there's going to be rationed healthcare. It's going to be. I hope we can prevent it. Thank you.
Stay right there. Yes, sir. Thank you. Wow. You know, you've given us so much to think about. You've challenged the organization. But the one thing that's hitting me when you talked about the patient and his or her healthcare footprint, by show of hands, how many physicians are there in the room? Put your hands up. What would you say to specifically, Montel, to every physician here, every clinician here at HMH? If in fact patients need to take more of a role in their own healthcare footprint, what can physicians do? One thing, not going to fix it overnight, one thing physicians can do to help their patients do just that.
It's going to sound crazy. I say lead by example. I have a doctor in Manhattan who just every time I see him, he lights me up. Because when I walk in his office, he's just finished a new class in physical fitness of some sort. He doesn't push it on me. He knows I work out. He knows that I exercise every single day. I try my best. I exercised this afternoon before I came in here, and I think that's part of the reason why I'm still doing as well as I'm doing after a stroke.
That's right.
But he leads by example. And unfortunately, some doctors don't put the effort in taking care of themselves, and they see a person and say, I want you to exercise. What?
The messenger matters?
Uh-huh. The messenger matters. But I also think that the program that you guys have started, when you're teaching
right.
your students to go out and interact with families, I think that's one that will help get the message across that we're more than just the guy you see when you want a pill. I want to know what you're doing at night. How are you doing? How are you feeling? You know
so here's the question. Our dean, the dean of the health, dean of the medical school right there, Benita Stan. Bonnie, could you put your hand up? So Montel's talking about what you're doing for newer physicians, right? So there's physicians of tomorrow. You have physicians here. What happens when they come together?
You know, you heard about this Bitcoin thing? Got a very, very interesting thought about this.
I didn't think Bitcoin would come up today, but go ahead.
why don't we, I got a weird little proposal for you, but how about come up with something called MedCoin for patients?
MedCoin. Go ahead.
Where I give you know, the science is cheap now. You can get a Fitbit thing to put on your wrist. You can get a journal. So what if I teach a patient how to journal what they eat? Journal their exercise, and I track it. And then Meridian Health gives them, this is not a coin that you go take to the bank and get $10 for, but I give you a med coin that if something happens to you, this is, you know, currency that will defer or lower some of your cost. So as a patient, what I work out every day, okay? I do it every day. I pay attention to what I eat. I try to eat a salad at least 5 days a week. I've lowered the amount of red meat that I put in my body. I'm eating red meat every 10 days. I'm eating fish probably 3 days, and I'm trying to be a vegetarian for 3 days. So Why can't I get a Bitcoin for that? A little, not Bitcoin, but a Megcoin. Mm. It says, I'm taking responsibility for my healthcare footprint. I'm supposed to see you by MMS. I probably should have seen you 3 times last year, but I came to see you twice, so I give you another coin for that.
Because you'd have to see me so much.
I'd have to see you so much. So now I'm earning some currency that will help lower my cost.
Economic incentive.
Why not? I'm just asking.
Bob Garrett's shaking his head. How many ideas in your head, Bob? The CEO is like, hey, what about that? You know, the Utah doctor.
Mm-hmm.
I'm curious about this. I'm sensitive to time as well, folks. Sure. I know. But there's a couple of things. The Utah doctor that you mentioned.
Mm-hmm.
I saw people's reaction when you were talking about how he communicated to you the situation. Mm-hmm. The lack of empathy, the lack of compassion. A big part of what's going on in the medical school, Bonnie, if I'm right, is the teaching of compassion and empathy. And to what degree do you believe that can and should be taught to physicians?
Oh, let me tell you. So imperative. I should tell you, sorry. You got me with this one. About 3 years ago, I have 4 children. My middle daughter called me up and she said, Dad, I had something wrong, something really weird. I fell down and I thought I hurt my back, but when they took x-rays, they saw something and, you know, I want to talk to you about it. And I'm telling you, when she said that to me, I immediately knew what was wrong. I don't know why, it just flashed in me, lymphoma. She said they saw something in her esophagus area when they did these x-rays. And I don't know why my brain went lymphoma, but guess what? I flew her, she was in Ohio, I flew her to New York. I literally got her to be able to go in and see the doctor who has written the last 2 protocols, MOP and the last one, for lymphoma. And he was the doctor who was able to treat her. So we're waiting in the hospital one day for another one of her sessions. And, you know, they said to her, look, you know, that she went through it, but she was treated for 3 months, walked out of there supposedly cured, and then 3 months later, it came back with a vengeance. When it came back with a vengeance, they knew that they had to do a stem cell transplant. So they wanted to know, my daughter said to me, she came to me crying, Dad, please, please, I don't want to be awake when they do that thing in my hip. I just don't. Can they just give me some drugs, put me to sleep, something like this? I said, okay, well, let me ask. I'm seeing the top doctor, supposedly, in this entire country who wrote the protocols. He said to me, and really now, the only reason why I was able to even have these conversations is because of the Affordable Care Act, she was on my health care insurance. So I was paying for her insurance, and I felt like I had the right to ask the daggone question. The doctor said, yeah, I'm going to tell her, I don't see any problem with that. Well, we'll have that happen. Jump forward 2 days later, I'm sitting in the little screening room with this nurse who came in. And this nurse came in and she sits down and she said, now, you know, we've got you scheduled for your stem cell removal. And she said, oh yeah, I know, they told me that, but they're gonna put me to sleep. She goes, I'm not putting you to sleep. And I said, wait, excuse me a second. And Dr. So-and-so said that she could be anesthetized, or she goes, that's not gonna happen. Well, you need to grow up. You need to, this nurse, like, you need to, we don't do that for anybody else. So, you know, you need to check yourself. And just because you're Mr. Williams, you're not, I said, whoa, hold on, wait a minute. I'm really sorry, I gotta tell you this, but I need you to get out of this room right now. She goes, you can't tell me that. I said, oh yes, I can, I'm paying for it, get out. She left. 2 minutes later, a supervisor came in and I said, how dare this nurse look her in the face after she says that the doctor said this was okay, and she says, man up. Who the hell do you think you are? My child has been, from her perspective, through hell and back. So, I mean, it was just that bedside manner. That's probably, I'm going to tell you something, folks. Seriously, in my 45 years of interaction with the medical community, I have never had a nurse say, and she may have been having a bad day. I don't know what her problem
that
was.
That hasn't been your experience.
Huh?
That wasn't your experience.
No, it was my child.
No, you were saying incredible things before. Then you get this one nurse.
One.
You wonder how that person even gets to be in that position.
Yeah, so, I mean, back to this thought, I think to be able to teach you know, compassion and
empathy.
Make sure that the staff does that in every interaction. If you got to stop for a minute and check yourself, I was talking about exercising, but you know what? I mean, honestly, I think one of the most important things that you can do as a community is doctors heal yourselves. Yeah. How many of you doctors spend an hour meditating a night? How many? How many of you do mindfulness drills for yourself every night? How many of you take care of you? The more you take care of you, the better you're equipped to take care of someone else. If you don't spend time and don't think it's that important, I'm telling you, you're crazy. Because that's part of the reason why some of you guys have the problems that you may have with your own families at home. I think it's not only is it important to teach empathy from the doctor to the patient, but I believe, doctor, heal yourself. Mm. We should be having, you know, monthly sessions with doctors to say, you know, how bad was that last case you had? And also, when you guys were talking about earlier, which I really thought was phenomenal, the discussion that you were having about end of life. I mean, it's a terrible discussion. Nobody wants to have it, but I swear to you, I'm telling you, we as a society have to get a grip and start to understand. My mother passed away a year ago. My mom had lung cancer. She's 86 years old. Lung cancer, had cancer in her throat, had congestive heart failure. And, you know, she went to the doctors, and the doctor said, well, I think we can do this, take out. She already had one lobe removed. We can take out another lobe. My father's standing back there, who's 88 years old, who works every single day right now as a tax attorney in the state. My father's going, well, yeah, we'll do this. My mother grabbed my arm and went, tell him no. I looked at my mom, looked at my dad. My dad wanted her to have another surgery that would have got her, what, another month? Another month laying in a bed. My mom was done. She said, I'm not doing it. You are not going to do that to me. And literally, I stepped out of the room. My mom and my dad had it out. But my mom just read him the riot act. You're not doing this to me.
She took control. Sorry,
she did. I closed the door when she said, you're not doing this to me. We need to be able to start teaching people that that's okay. I'm not saying that we got to give up on people, but
not at all.
You know, if the conversations were held a little earlier about what's it going to be like,
that's right.
Or you made that part of the entire interaction, and let's start that when you're young. I'm sorry. I think that, you know, I'm so blessed that I was able to get the treatment that I got for my stroke, and I'm glad nobody said that it was, you know, enough for you, Montel. I got several years left. But had I been laying in that bed the way most people recover from the same stroke that I had, I might have thought really hard about making a decision about not putting my family through that. Mm-hmm. But we don't have the discussions with people. We just walk in, we're going to save you. 95 years old, I'm going to save you. Really? Well, you'll save me 2 more days? Really?
You know, Montel, there's an expression, you know, you open up a can of worms. That can is a lot bigger than a can of worms right now. You have people thinking, challenging themselves, agreeing with a lot of what you said, questioning some things you said, questioning themselves right now. But you know, at a summit like this for HMH, I'd say, Bob and Jim, that's not bad. And you did that. And no, I would say this to you as someone, you know, there's the book Grit. Everybody's talking about grit, you know. This is grit. This is perseverance. This is somebody who does not know the meaning even close to quitting. And so you honor us by not just your presentation, but your presence, your enthusiasm, your attitude, and your commitment to helping others take control of their own healthcare footprint. Please join me in saying thank you to Montel Williams.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much, man. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for what you do. Thank you. Thank you.